I was born and raised in the Himalaya on the Tibetan Plateau. I grew up as a yak herder there. I never really imagined myself one day will be in the, up on the other side of the globe. After my middle school, I saw this, in China you prepare for this crazy college entrance exam called Gaokao. And it's a like a really intense, brutal examination that you memorize a bunch of stuff. And that I just felt like, oh, that wasn't my thing. I was never really good at tests. So I just like, I'm gonna go off to a different province and study English. And a lot of my classmates and village people, they're like, you're going insane. You will be out of that training school and not having a degree and you won't be able to get a job. But I'm kind of pretty stubborn in my own way. So I just like at age 16, I decided to travel to a different province, which is about 1,000 kilometers away. And I just started learning English. And through that, we did a lot of like a cultural revitalization project, which made me realize what I really want to do in the future. Specifically, I was focusing a lot on recording oral traditions in my village, which like all these fun stuff about collecting tongue twisters, riddles, proverbs, folk tales, those stories that I even never heard or imagined existed. So that was like, whoa, I'm so fascinated about my own culture. So I was like, I want to pursue this, whatever that I'm doing now, and I'm going to study something called linguistics. I don't know what it is. I don't know what exactly courses I will be taking, but I think it's something vaguely related to language and culture. So I just reached out to one of the English teachers. I said, hey, like, I don't want to go back to my hometown and study high school. I want to go study abroad. What do I do? So yeah, she was like, yeah, after I finished in the English training program, we didn't have, of course, a high school transcript. So we are starting off on a really bad situation. So we had to do a lot of work on nagging the school, the English training school principal to say, hey, I'm going to apply for schools in America and they require this thing called high school transcript, which I don't have one. I did a lot of studying here, so can I, hey, make up some scores roughly depending on my performance, and would you give me a stamp that just kind of says, okay, this is equivalent to high school degree. So that's how I kind of slowly build up, even not having a high school transcript. So it was a long journey of just got a lot of people's help. Otherwise it wouldn't, yeah, I would never ever imagine being possible to be here, yeah. Yeah, I mean, the first day or the first few days, it was just, I was really completely lost. I mean, one, I was in a completely like English-speaking country. I did learn English, but I was like, wow, I have to actually use and think in this language. And the first class, people were talking about things like course syllabus and readings, and I was like, what even like syllabus? What is like a syllabus? I was really like, I just like, I felt like, oh my God, maybe it's, I traveled so much, but is it too late to like say I don't think I can make it? But yeah, I'm overall, maybe because of my upbringing and some of my religious background, being a Buddhist, people tend to be very positive, and wherever you are, you kind of try your best and not pressure yourself too much. So I was kind of able to fight off that initial kind of shock being in a foreign country and like surrounded by even that class setting, you know, in sitting in the circle was something. I was, wow, the teacher is just like in front of me. Like there's no one between us, because in the culture I'm from, there's some sort of hierarchy of like power of like respecting the teacher. So the teacher is always like one step higher, like physically. So those were like just, cultural shocks in general. But I think after the first kind of freshman year, I just started talking to a lot of people and they're like, oh, a lot of students, they work. And that's how they make friends and getting their ways around campus and building up that network. So I just started applying for jobs and I started working in this space. It's like a lounge slash resource space where you plan a lot of events to bridge the connection between domestic student and international students. So I was the program director there, so I hosted a lot of events. So I met so many people who were kind of similar in my shoes. They're like, we also don't really feel like we completely belong here, but I remember one of the friend from Uganda, I just still remember, she said, oh, there's this famous TED Talk said, oh, you fake till you make it and you fake till you become it. I just tell myself like, oh, I belong here. I can do this. It's a foreign language, it's a foreign culture, but I can do it, I can make it. So I remember I went back home and I go, okay. I watched that TED Talk and I was like, oh, okay. I have to tell myself that every day as well. Slowly, I think after the second year, I was just like completely, I was like, okay, academically, socially, I felt like, oh, I can even now dream in English. One of our linguistic professor, because I speak a few languages, so he will always ask, what languages do you dream in? So by the second year, I was like, oh, I started dreaming in English. Yeah, I think first of all, I feel like, for me, taking care of my physical and mental health was really important. So I would do stuff like, oh, cooking a food that I really miss, like Tibetan food. So I will make momos and then invite some friends over. And that really made me feel grounded. And I feel like, oh, I can, recharges you and you feel like, wow, okay. Like small things like food and like just talking to your family back home on a regular basis, I think that really helped me personally. And then I think the other big thing that I felt like was really helpful was just for a lot of international students, it's easy to kind of form your own little community of people from the same country and kind of stay in that comfort zone and you just never really branch out. So you're that kind of information or resources limited to that community. So I have a pretty like outgoing personality. So I was always trying to reach out to different people from different backgrounds, different countries, different linguistic backgrounds. So I would just like even learn to say some of their phrases in their languages, and that brightens their day. And then in return, you know, you are happy as well. So kind of building up that network really helped me. And then the last thing I felt like it was really nice that we often forget is just celebrating small achievements. Whether that's just like going through a really hard, rough day. And at the end of the day, you tell yourself a little meditation session or whatever and say, oh, wow, I made through the day and here I am. I'm ready for the next day. So just like mentally and awarding yourself in like small achievements will really help you to not feel like you're not never really achieving to this bigger thing that you're thinking of. Yeah. I think there's a funny kind of story. As I was bored of my work, you know, I was trapped in China during the pandemic and I need to get out of this. So I started searching for programs, grad school programs. And then I was looking into computational linguistics because I, for the past 15 years, I've done a lot of language, endangered language documentation and revitalization work. So I soon kind of realized now we can use a lot of the technology that we have and then try to incorporate those into the workflow that we have for people who are doing like really grassroots work. So I just kind of landed on the UW computational linguistics page. And then there shows up like a familiar face on the first page. I'm like, oh, this used to be my colleague when I was, after I finished my undergrad, I worked for Apple for 3 years, 2 years remotely. And then she was one of my colleagues and she was on the first page. So I was like texting her, messaging her. I said, oh, have you attended this program? She was like, yeah, yeah. And I was like, I need a reference letter from you. So I think that was kind of the moment. I'm like, oh, this is great. I want to be, yeah. And I grew up in the nature and I love the Pacific Northwest, did my undergrad in Oregon. So I'm like, oh, this is wonderful. So everything kind of, all the stars aligned. Yeah, I think I'm from a culture I've really never framed in that way, like, oh, I'm the first, even in that region, to study abroad and learn English. So I never had that perspective maybe until I came here. Like, oh, wow, yes, I am the first person who decided to study abroad, even get a college degree. I think I'm the first in that region to get a master's degree. But I think I don't really see that as something like really special. I think there are a lot of people in my village are doing other amazing things. But I do feel when people ask me in the village, they're like, oh, what was your process like? And how did you apply? And how did you manage to go, like, get through all these years in a foreign country in English and still feel okay about it? And that's when I feel like I actually have to, like, oh, I have to formulate an amazing answer or, like, some inspiring story. So that's when I felt the pressure. I'm like, oh, I have to give, a pretty good inspiring story about, like, not just me saying, oh, I was trying to escape from high school, so I just didn't want to take that college entrance exam, so I just kind of stumbled upon all the opportunity. And so I think those are times when I really start reflecting actually what paths I took and how I can articulate in a way that's inspiring to the people who are in similar shoes or who are in similar path that they want to take. There's, I think, a great sense of responsibility, as much as it's kind of, when I think about it, wow, I just made it through all this odds and came here. There's times that I feel like, oh, wow, what an achievement. But most of the times it's, oh, I need to now share with my siblings who's going through similar. My brother is graduating high school, so he's thinking about applying for college and kind of trying to assist him and share some of my relatable experience with him. So it just feels there's some responsibility on my shoulder being the first person in the family or in the region even to go to college, yeah.